So, in this lecture, we will have Carlo Giunti, which is one of the main experts worldwide about sterile neutrinos. Since 20 years, he's working on short baseline anomalies. That is the topic of the lecture. Carlo is also author of one of the most famous neutrino books about neutrino physics and astrophysics, together with Kim. Okay, let's start.
Okay, thank you Stefano for the nice presentation and thank you to the organizers for the invitation to give these lectures. So I will discuss the anomalies in short baseline neutrino experiments and the explanation of this anomaly, possible explanation of this anomaly in terms of active sterile neutrino mixing. Before introducing the active sterile neutrino mixing, let me just summarize the main aspect of the standard three neutrino mixing paradigm that was discussed by Michele Maltoni at the end of his lecture. So, in the standard three neutrino mixing paradigm is a very successful and robust model which can explain the many data, so the solar, atmospheric, and long baseline accelerator and reactor neutrino oscillation data. And it is based on the assumption that the three flavor neutrinos that we know, the electron, muon, and tau neutrino, are superpositions of three massive neutrinos, nu one, nu two, nu three. And this is the mixing of the in the three neutrino framework that is given by the unitary 3x3 neutrino mixing matrix. One can calculate the oscillation probabilities in vacuum, and one can find that the oscillation probabilities, which are the transition probabilities as a function of distance L between the different flavors, depends on the elements of the mixing matrix, which give the amplitude of the oscillations. And the phase of the oscillation is determined by the so-called delta M square, so that these are the difference of the squares of the neutrino masses. And of course, this is these probabilities are oscillating as a function of distance L, and depend also on the neutrino energy E. In the standard three neutrino scenario, then there is a standard parametrization of the mixing matrix, which is written here. So it is written in terms of three mixing angles and one CP violating phase. And this is the Dirac CP violating phase. In addition, there can be two Majorana CP violating phases. But in neutrino oscillations, one can measure only the three mixing angle and the Dirac CP violating phase. Instead, the Majorana phases enter into the processes which violate the total electron numbers by 2 units. And so the neutrino oscillations in the framework of the neutrino mixing depend on two independent delta M squares. So there are only two independents. Difference of the square of the neutrino masses, which can be chosen to be these two. This can also be called the solar and atmospheric delta M squares because the smallest one, which is the delta M square 2-1, is relevant for solar neutrino oscillations. And this is the largest one, it is larger about by a factor of about 30. Is relevant for the atmospheric neutrino oscillations and also for the oscillations in the long baseline neutrino experiments. One can easily find, for example, if we consider neutrinos with a typical energy of reactor neutrinos, which is of the order of MeV, that is important because we will see that there are indication in short, of anomalies in reactor neutrinos. So in that case, if we can consider the solar delta M square, then this delta M square generate oscillations at a distance which is larger than about 50 kilometers. And the oscillation length is inversely proportional to the delta M square. So if we consider the delta M square atmospheric, then the oscillation occur at a shorter distance. But nevertheless, it is it must be longer than about 1 kilometer. So if one observes some oscillations, some anomalies, and that are due to oscillations at a shorter distance, then this cannot be explained in the framework of three neutrino mixing, because there is no delta M square which can generate such anomalies. And here I give some just a summary of the anomalies that have been observed, and in the following I will discuss each of them in more detail. So the anomaly, there is the reactor antineutrino anomaly, which is observed in reactor experiments, the gallium anomaly. So the reactor anomaly is at a level of 2.4 sigma, more or less, and the gallium anomaly is at a level of almost 3 sigma. So these are, as we will see, there are some problems in the interpretation of these anomalies. And there are also stronger anomalies observed in the accelerator experiments, which are the LSND and the MINIBOOM. And these are even larger anomalies, which are at the level of 4 sigma in LSND and even close to 5 sigma in MINIBOOM. So I say that what we need is a new delta M square. To get a new delta M square, we need a new massive neutrino, so beyond the standard 3 neutrinos. So one asks how many massive neutrinos there can be. We know that there are only three flavor neutrinos which interact with weak interactions, and this was done in the LEP experiments. So in the LEP experiments, what they observed is the width of the decay of the Z boson, and this Z boson can decay in the charged leptons, in quarks, and also there is the so-called invisible width of the Z boson, which measure which is the decay into neutrino antineutrino pairs. And by measuring this invisible width, one can determine which is the number of active neutrinos which interact with the Z boson. And as you can see here, these are the data. And the data fit very well three neutrinos, and two and four are completely out of the error bars. So the error bars are even enlarged here by a factor of 10 to be in order to be visible. So the measurements is done with a very high precision. And this is the original number, which is very close to three. But it showed some small deficit. This is the number that it was obtained by in this paper by the LEP collaboration, and it was revised very recently in this paper, and it is even closer to three. So the determination is without any doubt equal to three. So we know that there are three active neutrinos, but and this is in the flavor basis. So this is the basis of the interacting neutrinos. But we don't know how many, what is the number of massive neutrinos, because we can write the mixing in this way, in which the flavor neutrinos are superpositions of an arbitrary number of massive neutrinos that needs only to be larger than three. So there is no upper limit for the number of massive neutrinos that can exist and can mix with the flavor neutrinos. So at the level of the fields, the transformation of the neutrinos from the mass to the flavor basis must be done through a unitary and Bayesian mixing matrix. So this means that if we enlarge the number of neutrinos in the mass basis, we must enlarge also the number of neutrinos in the flavor basis. However, the new neutrinos are not interacting, so cannot interact because they cannot contribute to the invisible decay to the Z boson. So these neutrinos are sterile. And we don't know how many of them there are, and also what are the masses of these additional massive neutrinos. So, and this can be only determined by experiments, so by observing effects like anomalies in the oscillations experiments. So this is another way of seeing this presence of this additional massive neutrinos. So in this scale, I put the massive neutrinos, which are numbered according whichever number as a name. And in the flavor basis, instead of this, the colored basis is the flavor basis. And you can see that this flavor basis, the additional massive neutrinos must be mostly sterile because we want to have a minimal perturbation of the successful framework of three neutrino mixing. Because, as I said in the beginning, three neutrino mixing explain very well the solar atmospheric and long baseline data. So, if we introduce some new oscillations, this must be some small perturbation that does not affect much the oscillations of solar and atmospheric and long baseline oscillations. So, we can extend the framework by adding these massive neutrinos, but and they must be mostly sterile. But they must also have some small mixing with the active neutrinos, which is shown by these small sectors, colored sectors, in order to explain the short baseline anomalies. And here I must just warn that usually we talk about, to explain the short baseline anomalies, we need light sterile neutrinos. And strictly speaking, also these words, light sterile neutrinos, is wrong because the sterile neutrino does not have a mass. So the sterile neutrinos is in the flavor basis. But in the usual terminology, when we say light sterile neutrino or EV scale sterile neutrino, it means that there is an EV scale massive neutrinos which is mainly sterile. Okay, so then. I also wanted now again to explain why why we need at least one additional massive sterile neutrinos to have short baseline oscillations. So let us now look at this just illustration of the oscillations. And we have a source, which is a source of neutrinos with some definite flavor alpha, and a detector of neutrinos, which can detect neutrinos with a different flavor beta. And at the source, in the standard frameworks of three neutrino mixing, then the nu alpha is a precise linear combination of nu 1, nu 2, and nu 3.
Carlo,
Now,
just a second. There is a question in the chat.
yes.
I ask, could the new mass eigenstates also be smaller than the active ones?
In principle, yes, new mass eigenstate can be smaller, but in principle, yes. But if we need to have ED splitting, this is not favored by the data because then it will mean that the standard trino-trino masses are at the ED scale. So you can imagine that there is one sterile neutrino as a sub-ED scale, and then to have a delta M square of the order of ED squared, then the three normal neutrinos will be at the ED scale. And this is now excluded by the measurement of the Catlin experiment in tritium beta decay. And also it is disfavored by cosmology. I will mention that this later when I discuss the possible four neutrino schemes. Okay. So let me. I wanted to show in this slide that the trino-trino mixing cannot explain short baseline oscillation because if the distance between the source and the detector is not enough. Then practically, so these waves are just the waves, the waves of the trino-trinos, which have a very small difference because the masses are very, the mass difference splitting is very small. So if we put the detector very close, then there is a they cannot develop a significant difference in the phase, and we can approximate all the phases to be all the to be practically the same. Now, if we approximate all the phases to be practically the same, then we can put as a common factor the common phase, and then we end up with the same linear combination that of with which we started. This means that the neutrino does not change the flavor because this linear combination is the same as the original one. So the probability of transition into a different flavor is practically zero. So it is not zero, but it is much smaller than what can be detected and what can explain the anomalies. Instead, if we add a fourth neutrino, this fourth neutrino have a significant mass difference. So you can see here from this figure that it can develop a phase which is significantly different from the phases of the three normal neutrinos. So in that case, we cannot factorize the phases in a common phase, and this means that the neutrino which arrives at the detector is a different linear combination of nu 1, nu 2, nu 3, and nu 4, and this different linear combination has a projection which is different from zero from nu beta. So this means that one can detect have a probability to detect the neutrinos which was as an original flavor alpha into a different flavor beta. And the oscillation probabilities depend on the delta M squares which separate the fourth neutrino from the three light neutrinos. And in practice, since the delta M squares of the three light neutrinos is very small, all these three delta M square can be approximated to have the same value. So now let me only emphasize that sometimes some authors describe the oscillations, for example, in the LSND experiment, which observed the transition from nu mu to nu e as transitions of this type, from nu mu to nu sterile to nu e. But this is completely wrong. This is, as you can see from this picture, there is no intermediate sterile neutrino. What simply happens is that the oscillations are generated by the phase difference between the nu 4 and the three light neutrinos. So now let me describe what are the possibilities for the four neutrino schemes. So we have basically three groups of possible schemes, which are called 2 plus 2, 3 plus 1, and 1 plus 3. So the 2 plus 2 is two group of two pairs of masses which are separated by the new Schur baseline delta M square. And the difference between these two cases is that the two neutrinos which with a solar and atmosphere splitting are here are the solar are below and the atmospheric is above, and this is inverted. So this is similar to the difference between the normal and inverted schemes in the three neutrino mixing. The 3 plus 1 is the scheme that I showed before practically. So this is the scheme that I showed before. And the difference between these two is just that the three neutrino part, this is here the ordering is normal and here it is inverted. The 1 plus 3 are the two schemes which are those that are related to the question that I answered before, so in which the 4 neutrino is lighter than the 3 normal neutrino. So let us first look at the 2 plus 2 schemes. So actually, the after LSND experiment, the 2 plus 2 schemes were preferred because they don't suffer from what is called the appearance-disappearance tension that I will describe later. And there were many papers in which the data were analyzed using the 2 plus 2 schemes. But now this happened before the discovery of oscillation in 1998 by the Super-Kamiokande experiment for the atmospheric neutrinos and also the confirmation of the oscillation of the solar neutrinos by Snow and Kamland in the early 2000s. So at that time, the bounds from solar and atmospheric neutrinos were not very strong, and they allowed also some presence of oscillations of active sterile neutrino oscillations in the solar or atmospheric neutrinos. But as you can see here, the sterile neutrino must have a large mixing with some of these four massive neutrinos. So if it has a large mixing with nu one or nu two, then it means that there are large active sterile neutrino oscillation for in the case of solar neutrinos. And if there is a large, if the sterile neutrino has a large mixing with the nu three and nu four, then there are large active sterile oscillation in the case of atmospheric neutrinos. So this is not a perturbation of three neutrino mixing because there are large active sterile oscillation either for solar or atmospheric neutrinos. And this is now excluded by the data. And actually, the exclusion came in around 2004 when Michele Maltoni and collaborators they analyzed the solar and atmospheric data in the and also long baseline data in the case of 2 plus 2 schemes, and they can exclude this scheme. So let me now move to the realistic schemes, which are the 3 plus 1. And as I said before, the 1 plus 3 is disfavored because, as you can see here, there is a group of the three normal standard neutrinos must be at the electron volt scale. And this is disfavored by cosmology and also by the measurement of the neutrino masses in the Catrin experiment. So In practice, now we have as a possible option only the 3+1 schemes, which the ambiguity of the ordering of the three normal massive neutrinos. For the oscillation probabilities in Shaw-Bayes N experiments, it is possible to calculate them, neglecting the effect of the solar and the atmospheric daytime squares, because as I said, daytime squares generate oscillations at a much larger distance. So if we consider a short baseline distance, then only the daytime square for one, which is the short baseline daytime square, is relevant. And one can easily find that the oscillation probabilities are given by this formula. So this is for the appearance probability. So this is the transition from one flavor to a different flavor, from one flavor alpha to a different flavor beta. And this is the survival probability of some flavor alpha. And you can see that they have a rather simple expression, which is the same as the two neutrino oscillation probability. The only difference is that here we have different possibilities for the transition channel, for the oscillation channel. So we can have all type of oscillations between different flavors, and also survival of different flavor neutrinos are different, and they depend on some effective mixing angles, which are called theta alpha beta or theta alpha alpha in the survival probabilities. However, even if each channel has its own effective mixing angle for the oscillations, all these effective mixing angles are related to the to the same elements of the mixing matrix. So you can see that they depend only on the elements of the fourth column of the mixing matrix. And in particular, we will consider that only the disappearance of electron and mu neutrinos and the transition from nu to nu e. So in practice, everything that all the information that the main information that we have is on these two elements of the mixing matrix, UE4 and UMU4. And in the case also of 3+1 oscillations, then also in Shaw-Bayes N oscillation, one cannot have effects of CP violation, because you can see that these effective mixing angles depend only on the absolute value square of the elements of the mixing matrix. So the CP violation phases do not contribute to these oscillations. But there are several CP violation phases, and in particular in the case of oscillation, there are two additional Dirac CP violation phases with respect to the case of trino-trino mixing, and these phases can be observed if one looks at oscillation at larger distance. So one needs to probe the four neutrino oscillation in the atmosphere, in the long baseline experiments, or even in the solar experiments. It is useful to have a parametrization of the four neutrino mixing matrix. And many parametrizations are possible, but the most common one is this one that is also the most convenient. So this is just a generalization of the standard parametrization of trino-trino mixing, in which the trino-trino mixing part is multiplied by some appropriate rotation that involve the fourth neutrinos. And this form is convenient because in the limit in which the new mixing angle theta 1-4, theta 2-4, and theta 3-4 are very small, then one recovers the standard parametrization of trino mixing. And also because this parametrization is the one in which the first line and the last column of the mixing matrix assume the most simple form, and this is convenient for the analysis of the data. In particular, with this parametrization, you can see that the UE4 depends only on the theta 1-4, and we have an exact coincidence of the effective mixing angle in electron neutrino disappearance, short based and electron neutrino disappearance experiment with theta 1-4. For the new mu disappearance, it is slightly more complicated because there is a contribution of theta 1-4 here. But since we know that the mixing angle are small, then with a good approximation, the effective mixing angle for the new mu disappearance is almost equal to theta 2-4. So now let me just describe the anomalies. So the anomaly, the oldest anomaly is the LSND anomaly. The LSND anomaly was discovered in the middle 90s in the LSND experiment. So this is was an accelerator experiment in which that observed some possible transition from anti-nu mu to anti-nu e. And as you can see here, these are the data for this type of oscillations with respect to the background. And one can see that it is clear that there is an excess. This experiment, in principle, was a very good experiment to measure this type of transition because they had a very well-known pure source of anti-nu mu and a well-known detection process of anti-nu e. So let us see it in detail. So what they had is a proton accelerator, just produced protons that hit the target. This target produce positive pions, which are stopped in the target and decay at rest. So and then when they decay, they produce mu plus and nu mu. Then the nu plus decays and produce anti-nu mus. These anti-nu mus can oscillate, and the detector detects the anti-nu e with the well-known inverse beta decay process, which is also used for the detection of reactor neutrinos. So this has a cross-section which is very well known. So you can see here that in the source, there is no production of electron antineutrinos. So electron neutrinos are produced, but this cannot interact with this interaction. So this interaction can detect only electron antineutrinos. So the source does not have electron antineutrinos, and this is a very good experiment to test this type of transition. And so this is the signal is very large. The only problem is that, except maybe the mini-Boone experiment, no other experiment observed this signal. And in particular, it was not seen by the Carmen experiment, which used the same method. This is an experiment which was done at the same time. The only difference between the two experiments is that the distance of the Carmen experiment was shorter. It's about 18 meters. So the distance of the LSND experiment is 30 meters. So it is possible that the Carmen experiment was not far enough in order to see these oscillations, which develop after 18 meters, and they reached some peak around 30 meters. And the explanation of the LSND experiment in terms of oscillation gave rise to this allowed region in the plane of the delta square versus sin square 2 theta. So this is the delta m square for one, and this is sin square 2 theta mu e. So this is the effective mixing angle for the transition from muon to electron neutrinos. And the allowed region of the LSND experiment is the shaded one. And as you can see, most of this region is excluded by the negative results of other experiments, and in particular of the Carmel experiment. The exclusion is on the right of this red line. So, in practice, the LSD experiment can be explained by a Dayton square, which is of the order of one electron volt or slightly smaller. And so, this in any case must be larger than 0.1 electron volt, and it is much larger than the atmospheric Dayton square. So, this shows also that what I tried to explain before, that we need a new Dayton square. Now, let me discuss the gallium anomaly. The gallium anomaly is an anomaly which was discovered in the Galax and SAGE experiments. These experiments are the solar neutrino experiments, radiochemical experiments that detected the solar neutrinos through interaction with gallium that produce germanium and electron. But these are radiochemical experiments, so these are experiments in which they had a big tank of gallium, and every more or less 1 month they count the atom of germanium in order to extract what is the interaction, the detection rate. They tested this working of this experiment with artificial sources of chromium and argon. These are artificial sources which are very powerful, and they emit electron neutrinos, so the same type of neutrinos that is the solar neutrino, in electron capture process. And in this case, since this is a two-body final state reaction, then the energy of the neutrino is aligned. And in the case of chromium, it is about 0.75 MeV, and in the state case of argon, is 0.81 MeV. And the source, the activity of the source is well known because it can be measured by thermic wave, thermic method, because the source heats up, so by measuring the heat, one can determine the activity of the source. And so they found that the observed rate is smaller than the rate that is predicted without neutrino oscillations. And the Galax experiment made two of these source experiments, both with chromium, and the SAGE experiment made one with chromium and one with argon. And as you can see, there are two of these tests which are compatible, which have a ratio of experimental to calculated rate which is compatible with one, but two which show the significant deficit. So the average is given by this green line with the uncertainty which is given by the shadowed region, and this is well below one. So there is about 0.9 sigma deficit in these experiments. And these are really short baseline experiments because the size of these detectors is of the order between 1 and 2 meters, more or less. And the oscillation must occur within the detector. So it is clear that explanation in terms of neutrino oscillation of this anomaly requires a Dayton square which is larger than about one electron volt square. There is some problem related to the cross-section. So, as I said, the activity of the source is very well known. So, one knows very with good accuracy the flux of neutrinos which is emitted by the source. But the cross-section is not so well known, and some part of the cross-section be calculated. So the cross-section is the cross-section of the interaction of electroneutrinos with gallium. And if one looks at the nuclear levels, then take into account that the energy of the neutrino is larger than about 700 keV, then these neutrinos can excite can generate a transition from the gallium to the ground state of germanium, but also to some two excited states which are shown here, which are at higher energies. So now the so one needs to know the cross section from the gallium ground state to all three of these levels. Now the cross section for the transition from the ground state of gallium to the ground state of germanium, this is well known because one can measure the lifetime of germanium, and so one knows what is the strength of the interaction between the two ground states, and one can transform the knowing this lifetime of germanium, one can calculate the cross section from the transition between the two ground states. But there is no data on the on these higher levels, so the transition from the gallium to these two excited states must be calculated. And one can write, so the total cross section is the ground state cross section times one plus the contribution of the two excited states. And this is written in terms of some coefficients which are known, which take into account the phase space, and these are the strengths of the interaction, which is called the Gamow-Teller strengths. And this must be calculated or estimated through different reactions. Now the contribution of these two levels is not high, it's about 5%, but this is crucial in order to evaluate the size of the gallium anomaly. And there have been different calculations of this of the total cross section, so that take into account this cross section to the excited states. And the first one was done by Bacol around 95, and it gave some value of the cross section, which is practically was is considered the standard value, which is used also for the analysis of the solar experiment. Later, in the late 90s, there was a calculation of Axton that this is a shell model calculation that gave a much larger, well, relatively larger cross sections, which increase the anomaly, because if you have a larger cross section, then you can you have a prediction of a larger rate, and so the deficit increases. There was another calculation using some measurements of nuclear charge exchange reactions done by the group of Freckers and others, which found a cross-section which is just slightly larger than the Bacol cross-section. And most recently, in this paper, my Finnish collaborators used a shell model calculation in which they predict a cross section which is significantly smaller than the Bacol and the Frecker cross section. So, in this case, using this last shell model calculation, then the anomaly is diminished. And this plot on the left shows the allowed region in the plane of Dayton square versus UE4 that is obtained by using these different cross sections. So as you can see, the largest anomaly, which is The region which inside this green line is the one that one obtained with the Axon cross-section. So the largest anomaly because it requires a mixing uniform which is as large around 0.1. If we use the Axon, the Bacall and Frequency cross-section instead, the anomaly is slightly smaller, so the region moves to values of of this mixing, which is smaller. And if we use this recently evaluated Shell model cross-section, then the mixing can be even very small, smaller than 10 to the minus 2. So this is an indication that there is some uncertainty in the evaluation of the gallium anomaly. So there is some deficit, but we don't know how much is this deficit, so and how significant is this anomaly. So it is important that the new experiment test this anomaly in a possible model-independent way, so in the way which is independent from the cross-section. And there was an experiment in that was planned to be done in Gran Sasso, which is called SOX, using the Borexino detector, that unfortunately was canceled for several problems. And the only experiment which is underway is the so-called BEST experiment. This is the experiment which will be done in the Baksan, so in Russia, in the Baksan laboratory, using this an equipment which is so this is the same place where the SAGE experiment is. So they use they are using the gallium that was using the SAGE experiment, and they constructed a new tank in which they have two concentric regions, and they can measure the different rate in the two regions. And if they found rates which are different in the two regions, then they can prove, independently of the knowledge of the cross-section, that there is some disappearance of the electron neutrinos between the inner region and the outer region. So this is a model-independent way to test the gallium anomaly, and I think this experiment is underway, and maybe it will give results in the near future. So let me now discuss the reactor electron antineutrino anomaly, which is more well known. So this reactor electron antineutrino anomaly is a consequence of a new calculation of the reactor antineutrino fluxes that was done in 2011. So before 2011, the data of the short baseline reactor neutrino experiments were in agreement with the previously calculated prediction of that used the previous calculated fluxes. So these were calculated by Vogel and collaborators many years before. And but in 2011, this calculation was improved, and what they found is that the prediction of the fluxes is a few percent higher than what it was before. So this means that the reactor data are show a deficit of the rate that is observed. And in this plot, I show a summary of the data, including the most recent data. So this is just a figure that I calculated just very recently, and using the most updated data. And in particular, we use the data of the near detector of the long baseline experiments, Daya Bay, Double Show, and Reno, and also new data from the stereo experiment in France, which is a short baseline experiment. And as you can see, the data, most of the data are below one here in this ratio, and the average is given by this number, and this shows a 2.4 sigma deficit. So this is an anomaly, not a very strong anomaly, but nevertheless an anomaly which is interesting and maybe a hint of short baseline oscillations. This is another way to see the data. So these are the same data plotted now considering a possible oscillations of electron antineutrinos due to active sterile mixing. So these are short baseline oscillations. And I plotted here the survival probability for three different values of the del time square. So you can see that if we consider a del time square, which is 0.1 electron volt, this is given by the blue curve. This blue curve here is oscillating here, so it cannot fit with the data. In order to fit the data, what is preferred is to have something flat here and maybe some oscillations here. And in order to do that, one needed to have oscillations at a shorter distance, so to increase the value of del time square. And the best fit is obtained in the case of the del time square, which is larger than about 0.5 electron volt, that maybe one can have some oscillation here, which can explain also this low lying point, and something flat here. So this illustrates that the reactor antineutrino anomaly requires a del time square which is of the order of one electron volt square. And there is also an illustration here of what is the effect of the oscillations at larger distance. So at a larger distance, then the energy resolution of the detector, if one takes into account the energy resolution of the detector, then the oscillations are averaged. So the effective oscillations are averaged. And the near detector of the long baseline experiment, Reno, Double Show, and Diabay, cannot see an effect of the, I mean, some distortion of the spectrum or the variation of the probability as a function of distance, which is due to the active sterile oscillations. As you can see here, what they can see is only a constant suppression with respect to the prediction. If we go farther and we consider the far detector of the Double Show, Reno, and Diabay, then this variation is due to the standard theta 1-3. So this is the standard oscillation in the framework of trino-trino mixing. And here the effective del time square is the atmospheric del time square. So, but what is important is that here this experiment cannot see a distortion of the energy spectrum to do the to do the, due to the to the short baseline active sterile neutrino oscillation. And this is important to evaluate the reliability to evaluate to understand if maybe the problem of the 5 mV bump that was observed in the Double Show, Reno, and Diabay experiment explained with the oscillation. So the answer is no. So this is a bump, so an excess which is observed at about 5 mV in this in the near detectors of this experiment here. And oh, there was some question, but I did not have time to read it. Okay, Stefano, if there is some question, please tell me. Okay, so
just now one appeared on the chat. So, how would the theta slide 26 look like for higher delta m squared? And probably
Sorry, can you repeat?
referenced. So, slide 26.
Yes,
I'm
slide
back.
26.
So, Francesco Motti is asking what would happen for higher delta m squared, probably thinking about the best fit for neutrino 4.
Okay, higher delta m square, practically the oscillation will occur even at shorter distances, and here the disappearance probability will be flat. So also that gives a good fit. In fact, I mean, not the best fit, but a reasonable fit of the short baseline neutrino data. And in fact, as we will see later, the allowed region in the for the reactor antineutrino anomaly extend also to larger value of delta m square. So the preferred value is delta m square about 1 electron volt, but also larger values are allowed. So, but the important point is that the reactor neutrino antineutrino anomaly depends on the ca theoretical calculation of the fluxes. And the theoretical calculation of the fluxes in 2011, it was thought to be very solid. So there was a lot of noise about this reactor antineutrino anomaly. But then in 2000, the claim uncertainty was about 2%. But then in 2014, these experiments discovered this famous 5 MeV bump or 5 MeV shoulder that shows that the spectrum that is calculated spectrum cannot be correct because it cannot reproduce the data around 5 MeV. So this puts a serious question to the validity of the calculations. And it was not clear until it is not clear what is the indication of this 5 MeV bump and or possible something incomplete in the calculations that for the reactor antineutrino anomaly. So, as I said, this 5 MeV bump cannot be explained by short baseline oscillations because short baseline oscillation cannot generate a distortion of the spectrum in this detector, which are at a larger distance of about 500 meters. If it is a theoretical miscalculation of the spectrum, which is the most likely case, it can have opposite effects on the anomaly. And more recently, in the about in 2019, there were two different calculations. New calculation of the reactor antineutrino flux, which pointed exactly in two different directions in the anomalies. For the anomaly, the first calculation was the calculation by the Finnish group, in which they explain this as an excess. So obviously, if your flux is increased, so if there is an excess and your flux is increased, then this increases the anomaly. And the different calculation instead was done by this French group, in which they instead find a suppression of the. They explain this bump not as an excess here, but as a suppression here. And then this decreases the anomaly. And then there is also a new calculation, which I will describe in more detail later. So let me just look better at these new calculations. I think I will skip some slides because I don't have enough time to finish. So if you want, then later in the discussion, you can ask me questions about how the reactor neutrino fluxes are calculated. So this is the French paper in which they predict a total neutrino flux, which is smaller than the standard flux, which is called the Huber-Muller model. So this is called the Estienne-Fallot model. And as you can see here from this figure here, this is the ratio of of their prediction with respect to the flux spectrum, which was observed at Daya Bay. So they have a better agreement in this region with the Daya Bay spectrum. But they have still they cannot explain the 5 MeV bump. So as a result of the calculation, the flux total flux is reduced, and if one do the same fit as what I showed before using this Estienne-Fallot fluxes, then as you can see, the average here is just slightly below one, but one is just about at 1 sigma. So practically, the data are compatible with the prediction at level of 1 sigma, and that there is no anomaly. So if this calculation is correct, then the anomaly disappears. Instead, the Finnish group, they calculate the fluxes with a different method. So the French group use the so-called summation method. Instead, the Finnish group use the conversion method. And in that case, what they did is to add the effect of forbidden transitions in the nuclear decays. And in this way, they can, as you can see here, this is the spectral change compared with the data which are given by the black points. And they can more or less explain at least part of the 5 MeV bump, which is in this region, adding the effect of forbidden transitions in the calculation of the reactor neutrino flux. How are the
There is a question, you see it?
Yes, how I missed some how are the
The different
energy.
measured neutrino energies taken into account in the reactor anomaly plot.
Well, I mean, all the reactors emit a flux which have similar energies. Not exactly the same, because the energy of the neutrino depend on the fuel composition of the reactor. But the energies is a few around 1 MeV, and these are the total rates, so one must integrate the predicted rate over multiplied by the cross section over the total detection range. So I think that is not, I mean, it is easy to take them into account, and there is no big uncertainty on that. Actually, the uncertainty is negligible. So the uncertainty is in the flux. So that is the main problem. As I try to explain here in this calculation, they add the forbidden decays, which give an excess, which can at 5 MeV, which can explain at least part of the bump. So this means that their prediction for the fluxes is higher. And as a consequence, the anomaly increases with respect to the Huber-Muller anomaly. So the anomaly from 2.4 sigma increases to 2.7 sigma. And most recently, there was a very interesting paper by a Russian group. So this group, they measured the beta decays of the rate of the electrons which are emitted by reactors. In particular, the rate which is emitted by the fuel which is composed by uranium-235. So what they measure is the rate of the emitted electron by the ratio between the electrode emitted by uranium-235 and plutonium-239, which is important quantity for the so-called conversion method. So the conversion method is based on the transformation of the measurement of the electron ray spectrum to the neutrino spectrum. And what they found is that this ratio of the electron emitted by uranium-235 and plutonium-239 is smaller than the one that was measured in the ELL experiment that is used by in the Huber-Muller model and also in the Finnish model in order to transform to obtain the neutrino spectrum from the electron spectrum. Now, and what they argue is that in ELL, the evaluation of the plutonium-239 spectrum was correct. And so they inferred that there was an overestimation of the emission in uranium-235. So what they argue that the prediction for the uranium-235 part of the flux must be decreased by a small fraction, about 5%. And this, of course, decreases the total amount of the fluxes. I mean, decreases the contribution of uranium-235, so also the total is decreased. And if one takes into account this correction, then practically the anomaly completely disappears. And as you can see here, the average rate is completely compatible with one. And there is also an approximate agreement with the summation method of the French group. So now it may be that the reactor antineutrino anomaly is solved, but this is still an open question because this is a very recent measurement and it has not been confirmed by other experiments. And so the question remains open. And that is why recent experiments have tried to test the reactor antineutrino anomaly by using comparing not the rate with the absolute rate with the predicted rate from the flux, but by measuring the rate at different distances. So one can, if one see a variation of the rate with a distance, then one can test the oscillations independently on the flux, just by making the ratio of the rate observed at different distance. And this was done is done in these experiments. So this is the NEOS experiment, which is in Korea. Actually, this had the only one detector, but they compare the fluxes with the Daya Bay flux, and also recently they had a paper they compare a flux with the Reno flux, which is observed at a different distance. So by comparing the fluxes at two distances, so they have a detector at 22 meters, but the Reno near detector is 500 meters. So by comparing the rate at these two distances, then they can see if there is there are oscillation in a model-independent way. The dust detector is in Russia, and they use a solid scintillator detector, which is in the lifting platform, which can be moved at a distance from the reactor, I think between about 9 and 11 meters. So by looking at the difference, they can see the oscillations. Neutrino 4 is also a detector which detects a detector which is on some moved or that can be moved horizontally at a different distance. Prospect is a segmented detector which is very large, so they can see the oscillations at different distances inside the detector. Stereo also is a detector which has six sections at different distances, so they look at the difference of the rate at a different distance. And also solid is a long detector. This is in Belgium, this is in French, and Prospect is in the States. So this five detectors experiment already gave results in the solid. I think they are working and they will give some result soon. What we can do is a combined analysis of the data of these experiments. And here I show the results of the combined analysis of the available data in 2018, 2019, and 2020. So in 2018, there were the available data on NEOS and DANSE and also Prospect. And there was also some constraint of previous old experiment, Bouguer, which also had two detectors. So this is an experiment in the 90s. But as you can see from this figure here, so the NEOS experiment gave some preferred allowed regions, which are inside these red curves. And the DANSE experiment gave some preferred regions which are inside the magenta curves. And you can see that DANSE has some allowed region here, here, and here. But most relevant is this region here, which overlaps in a rather impressive way with a similar region which is obtained in the NEOS, was obtained in the NEOS experiment. So in 2018, there was a remarkable agreement between DANSE and NEOS, and this seemed to be a rather convincing indication in favor of oscillations. And as you can see here, this region is also not excluded by the Bouguer 3 curve, which is this one, and by the Prospect curve, which is this one, that exclude what is on the right. So this region was allowed, and it was an interesting indication in favor of short baseline oscillations. But the situation became worse in the following years, and in particular, the DANSE experiment continued to give data. And in the 2019, the allowed regions of the DANSE experiment, as you can see, enlarged. And there was so the indication in favor of oscillation decreased, and there was still some overlap here with the NEOS region, but at the level of 3 sigma, you can see that even no oscillation, I mean, the case of no oscillation, so zero mixing is allowed. So here there was an indication in favor of oscillation at more than 3 sigma. Here it is between 2 and 3 sigma. And the data of DANSE in 2020, 19 show even no indication of any oscillations. And as you can see here, the allowed region, now the DANSE curve has become an exclusion region. So there is no allowed region at 2 sigma, and now even at 2 sigma, zero mixing is allowed. So in practice, indication of this model independent indication in favor of this oscillation has decreased in the last years, and in practice, it is seems to be fading away. So what remains from this experiment is some constraint on the value of UV4. So the region, the white region here, is excluded at 3 sigma from the global fit of these experiments. There is some statistical problem in the interpretation of these experiments, which is related to the fact that often the fluctuation of the data can be fitted by by oscillation. So there is a fake fit of the oscillations, which is just due to the fluctuation of the data. So the interpretation of the oscillation experiment is subject to this uncertainty. There is a more robust way to test the presence of the sterile neutrino at the electron volt scale and the mixing of this neutrino by measuring the defect in the tritium beta decay. So, and in general, in all the beta decay, but tritium beta decay is the most sensitive. So this is a kinematical measurement, so it is very robust, and it uses the same method that is used to detect the masses of the three light neutrinos. So what they look is to some distortion of the spectrum of the emitted electron. And this is just an illustration in the case of an effective electron neutrino mass larger than zero. And you can see that if one considers this Curie function, which is enters here in the decay rate, as a function of the kinetic energy T of the emitted electron, then there is a distortion here at the endpoint of the spectrum, and the endpoint of the spectrum ends at the Q minus the effective mass of the electron neutrino. And the most recent data of Catrin limit this mass at the level of about 1 electron volt or smaller. If there is an additional sterile neutrino, so this means that there is an additional massive neutrino at the electron volt, and in that case, the Curie function gets also a contribution from the additional massive neutrino, and the contribution can be written here in this way, where one separates the contribution of the three light neutrinos in an effective beta mass, which takes into account only the three light neutrinos. So this is similar to the effective electron neutrino mass that I considered in the previous slide. And the additional contribution of the massive neutrino for massive neutrinos is given here. So what one expected to observe is, if this massive neutrino exists, is some distortion of the spectrum here, which occurs at Q minus the mass of the neutrino. Here I forgot to say that Q is the so-called Q value, which is the maximum kinetic energy of the emitted electron in this decay. So at the value, if one observes some distortion at some value here of the kinetic energy of the emitted electron, one can measure the mass of the new neutrino, and by looking at the deviation from the straight curve, one can measure also the mixing. So this is a very powerful way to measure both the mass and the mixing. Now, some limits on the mass of the mixing of the discordant neutrino was obtained already in the MIND and TROIK experiments, which published some limit on the effective mixing as a function of the mass, which is shown in these two plots. And most recently, the cutting experiment did not observe any of this distortion of the spectrum, and this allowed to put a limit in the plane of the ma of the of these parameters, the m squared for one and psi squared to theta e he, which is given by this blue line. Combining this with the old main centroids experiment, one can get a bound which is given by this red line, which extends also to smaller values of the of the mixing angle. And as you can, and here the shaded region is the so-called the region which is allowed by the reactor antineutrino anomaly. So you can see that this region extends to larger delta m square, as I said before, and these experiments, Catherine tritium experiment, can constrain the large, so exclude the large delta m square part of this region. And these are only the first Catherine data, and in a few years the Catherine will improve, take more data, and extend their sensitivity to a region which is at a lower delta m square, so it will be more interesting to reach this preferred region. This is the figure that was published by the Catherine collaboration in Neutrino 2020, and as you can see here, there is allowed region which is the red one, which is the allowed region of the neutrino 4 experiment. So I did not have time to comment the neutrino 4 experiment, but this experiment is a different gives a different result with respect to the others, and it points strongly to an allowed region that is shown here. There are many doubts on this allowed region, but at the end, it is needed that some experiment test this allowed region, and the Catherine experiment is very promising for testing it in a model independent way this region in the near future. At the moment, they just touch the larger missing part of this region, but in the future, they probably can test either exclude or confirm this this region in a reliable way. So let me now discuss the global framework. So the global framework is the one in which we must take into account the also the LSND and Binibun signals. And also not only the so, and then we have three type of observation. One is the electron neutrino disappearance, that is the reactor neutrinos and the gallium neutrinos, the gallium experiments, the anomaly observed in the gallium experiments. Then we have the LSND and Minibun indication of new mid-to-new transitions. And we must take into account also the bound on nu mu 4 given by the nu mu disappearance experiment. And as we will see in the following slide, there is no indication of this nu mu disappearance, so there is a bound on the size of 4. So we know that the UE4 must be small, and UE4 also must be small. And this means that the amplitude of nu mu to nu transition is quadratically suppressed. So this means that the allowed oscillations, the oscillations which are allowed for nu mu nu transitions, taking into account the bound from disappearance experiment, is constrained, and this generates the so-called appearance disappearance tension, because this the size of this quantity is not enough to explain the LSND and Minibun signals. So this is a summary of the data for new mu to new transition in short baseline experiments. As you can see, there are many experiments, several experiments, and most of them correspond only to a curve, which is an exclusion curve, and they exclude what is on the right. The only two experiments which have some closed curves are the LS&D, which is the blue one, and the mini boom, which is the red one. And so in this case, the allowed region is inside the closed curves. And you can see that most of the allowed regions is excluded by other experiments. And if we make a global fit, then we find a global allowed region from appearance data at the level of one electron volt square here, and a mixing which is must be is relatively small, so it's smaller than about 10 to the minus 2 for this effective mixing parameter. Okay. I will skip the discussion of mini boom because my time is almost over. If you want to under my comment of mini boom, you can ask later in the discussion. So we must take into account the nu mu disappearance bound, and also here there are several experiments, and all of them neither of them observed some disappearance, and they all put some bound, and the most stringent bound is the one which was obtained relatively recent by the minus plus experiment. And as you can see here, the global fit is given by this red line. So this element of the missing matrix is strongly constrained. I skip this description. Oh, sorry. And I go to the global fit. So that is illustrated this appearance disappearance tension. So as I said before, we have a bound on from nu disappearance of UE4, a bound from nu mu disappearance on nu mu 4, and the nu mu to nu e appearance is doubly is quadratically suppressed by these two bounds. So this tension is illustrated here in this figure. So this is a figure which is relative to global fit in 2016, and you can see that here the allowed region from appearance experiment is this blue one, which is correspond to the one that I showed you two slides before. And this, so the allowed region from the appearance experiment is here inside this blue line. But the new disappearance experiment, they constrained this mixing by the magenta curve. So the region on the right is excluded, and the new disappearance by this dark red curve. So taken separately, they are not very relevant because they cannot exclude the appearance region. But when we combine them in this way, as I said, the bound becomes quadratically suppressed. So if we combine these two in this way, then we get the bound which is given by the red line. So the red line excludes everything that is on the right. And you can see that it excludes most of the region which is allowed by the appearance experiment. So this means that the disappearance experiment are in tension with the LS&D and the mini boom signal. In 2016, this tension was not was strong, but not too strong, and it made sense to find an allowed region called global allowed region, which is given by the shadow with the region. So in the global allowed region, the total goodness of fit is good. There is no problem in the total goodness of fit, but the tension is not cannot be quantified by the total goodness of fit because there are many data, and the goodness of fit I mean, the tension is washed out in the global goodness of fit. What one needs is the so-called parameter goodness of fit that measure the tension between two different set of data, and the tension between the appearance and the disappearance data using the parameter goodness of fit in 2000 was extended to the minus 4. So this was already some rather strong tension, which showed that there was some problem in the global fleet. Let me just say that if we extend the framework of the neutrino mixing to more than one sterile neutrino, then the tension cannot be diminished. Here I have some explanation of the parameter goodness of fit that I can do if in the question time if somebody wants. So the problem is that after 2016 the situation become worse because there were new data, especially from reactor neutrino experiments. And in 2018 there seemed to be some allowed region here that was indicated by this agreement between NEOS and DANSS experiments that I discussed before. But the most, if we take into account the most recent data of the DANSS and other experiments, then as you can see here, the exclusion region of the disappearance experiment, I mean the exclusion curve is rather far from the allowed region of the appearance experiment. So the tension is really strong. The parameter goodness of fit is at a level of 10 to the minus 11. So this shows that the fit is completely not acceptable. One can still find a global fit region here, shown by the shadow of the region, but it has no meaning because the tension is too large. The important point is that in any case, we remain with the LSND and Mini-Boon anomaly that and we need to understand if they are true or not. And in the near future, new experiments will check in a model independent way these anomalies. And this is the so-called short baseline neutrino program in Fermilab, which will use different detectors at different distances. And these detectors are also liquid argon detectors, which can detect well the signal of appearance of electron antineutrinos. And most important is that they detect, they can distinguish the signal of electron neutrinos from the photon background. And that was this was not possible in the LSND and Mini-Boon experiments. And you can see that these experiments and some other experiments in Japan, they can cover the allowed region for the new mini disappearance indicated by the LSND and Mini-Boon anomaly. They will need also to find that also new mu disappear. And this is the sensitivity of these detectors, and they will need to, I mean, if they confirm the LSND or Mini-Boon oscillation, they need to find some allowed region here that is in tension with the existing bound on new mu disappearance, because this needs to this if they find oscillations which are compatible with LSND and Mini-Boon, it means that the interpretation of some experiments of the on new mu disappearance or new mu disappearance is not correct. So I see that I just went over my time. I just flashed some slide with a short comment. There is some interest also in observing the effect of short baseline neutrino oscillation in long baseline experiments, and there are many papers studying this possibility, especially for the next DUNE experiment. And there is also an important effect if the neutrino if this new neutrino at the electron volt scale exists, there is also an important effect in neutrinoless double beta decay. And one can predict that a signal of neutrinoless double beta decay in the normal ordering case, which is relatively large and can be tested by the next generation of experiments. Here I give some incomplete and old list of many papers which studied the effect of sterile neutrinos at electron scale in other experiment like supernova neutrino detection, cosmic neutrinos, and even connection with the dark matter and also with cosmology. I have several slides of alternative explanation of mini-moon that are not oscillation explanation, but they still require a sterile neutrino, but this will be needs to be a heavy sterile neutrino. And I go to the conclusion. So, conclusion is that these anomalies at Shaw Basin are very interesting, and they may indicate that some sterile neutrinos exist, and this will be a really revolution in in physics because sterile neutrinos are particle beyond the standard model. So it is very important to pursue the search for sterile neutrinos in order to find possibly new physics beyond the standard model. And historically, the light sterile neutrinos and where the existence of light sterile neutrinos was motivated by the three Shaw Basin anomalies, the reactor, the gallium, and LSND anomaly. We have seen that the reactor neutrino anomaly practically is fading away. So it's not definitely excluded, but there is some reasonable doubt that this anomaly exists. The gallium anomaly needs to be tested, and we need some independent check at the only experiment that will be done. Is the best experiment in Baksan. And we have seen that we can test also the existence of sterile neutrinos through the effect of the neutrino mass in the beta decay and also in neutrinoless double beta decay experiment. The LSND and mini-moon excesses can be explained by neutrino oscillation, but we have this problem of the appearance disappearance tension. So the existence of this signal needs to be confirmed, and we hope that this signal, I mean, this problem will be solved in a definite way with the new experiments, especially the Shaw Basin neutrino program in Fermilab, that should clarify in a final way if these anomalies exist or not. There are also some non-oscillatory explanation of these anomalies, but I must say I do not have time to discuss them. They are rather ad hoc. So in contrast to the oscillation explanation, which is rather general and can explain a lot of phenomenological observations with only by adding one sterile neutrino without a strong constraint on its mass and mixing, then the heavy sterile neutrinos they require not only additional sterile neutrino but also a additional sterile neutrino which have some specific new properties like a very high large magnetic moment or new interactions. So these are more exotic explanations which I think must be considered as a second option. So I think I finished my lecture and I open to questions.
Okay, thanks, Carlo. There is a question by Jordan Seneca. Can you unmute and ask this question? Yes.
Yes, could you go to slide 54, please?
Yes. It's a little bit slow to go.
Well, maybe I can ask the question first. So I think the Site 54 shows the evolution of the allowed regions for some kind of measurements from 2016 to later
Yes.
years. And I'm a bit surprised by how much the allowed region moves. It seems like from year to year, the best fit value just completely moves away from the previous three sigma region. And if this was due to statistical uncertainties only, I would expect this to be really unlikely to happen. So somehow there needs to be some really strong systematic effects. How is this explained?
Well, from 2016 to 2018, there was an agreement because practically there was a restriction of the allowed region by the reactor neutrino data due to this agreement that I described between the NEOs and DANSS. So practically what before was some broad exclusion curve here, it was restricted to only to some two values of delta M square. And you can see that here this region more or less is included in this one. So here there was an agreement. So it was an improvement of a previous measurement. There was more tension because the region required a smaller mixing, but I will say that they are consistent. Now, the problem now is that practically the reactor antineutrino anomaly has disappeared, at least practically disappeared considering this model-independent measurements. And we are again with a broad exclusion curve, and now the tension is completely out of control. So it is dramatically decreased. So I showed this allowed region here, but they have no physical meaning because the tension, you can see that there is completely the allowed region from this disappearance experiment, the allowed region from appearance experiment are completely disjoints. So they are completely incompatible. And obviously, one can always do a combined fit and find the minimum of the chi square and calculate some allowed region. But these regions have no, I think, no physical meaning. I showed here only just to show them. But we cannot believe that these regions have any reliability, I'd say.
All right, so let's say in 2019, this opening up of the allowed region in the disappearance is partly due to this new modeling to explain the reactor anomalies.
No, because now the reactor anomaly is calculated in this global fit using the data of the experiments which measure the flux at different distances. So we don't use, I mean, in the old, many years ago, I think maybe also here in 2016, we used the absolute rate. So we used the data of the original reactor antineutrino anomaly. But after that, we had the first results of this experiment, like NEOs, DANSS, which measure the flux at different distances. So their results is independent on the calculation of the neutrino flux. So in this 2018 and 2019, we don't use the absolute measurement of the reactor neutrino flux, but we use only the data from this different distance measurements, like we use DANSS, Prospect, Stereo, and NEOs. We exclude the neutrino 4 because, as I said, neutrino 4 give a result which is very doubtful. because it requires a mixing of the electron neutrino, which is too large. So this will not be what I call the perturbation of the three neutrino framework, because it requires a value of UE4, which is very large, and it will have a significant effect, for example, in the solar neutrino data. And in fact, the result of the neutrino 4 is in contradiction with the solar neutrino data. So we did not don't use that.
All right, thank you. That clears it up.
Is there any other question? Yes, please, Lisa.
Yeah, maybe just a small question to this. So exactly the same slide. So therefore, with the neutrino 4 result, there was this discussion that there are problems in the statistical treatment, that the chi-square statistics, it doesn't follow the expected chi-square distribution. Is this taken into account in this global fit as well?
No. I worked on that problem, and we have also published a paper in which we show that this neutrino 4 practically has this statistical problem that is due to the fact that some random fluctuation of the data can be affected by oscillation. And this give a wrong indication in favor of oscillation. So in order to do that, I mean to make a proper statistical analysis, one needs to do something very complicated. Usually these allowed regions here, they are just evaluated by considering a fixed delta chi square with respect to the global, to the minimum, that is the chi square, which correspond to some confidence level. And we use just assume that the chi square, I mean, what we call a chi square, that is a least square function, is a chi square distribution. But in reality, the distribution is not a chi square distribution. And to make a proper statistical analysis, one has to evaluate the distribution of the test statistics for each value of the mixing parameters. So this is a huge calculation which can be done for some if we consider one experiment, and we have done for four experiments, but to do it for the global fit is impossible. Because this is a computationally very demanding, and it requires to run hundreds of CPUs for many days if we consider one experiment. So to do it in the global fit is completely not doable. So in principle, if we were able to do it, then we could consider also the neutrino 4 data in this fit. Because that will be a proper treatment of this data. But since we are not able to do this proper statistical calculation, we have to exclude the neutrino 4 data by hand.
But doesn't all the neutrino oscillation experiment that are sensitive to the shape of the oscillation have this problem? So not only neutrino 4, but also the others?
Yes. Also, the other experiments have the same problem, but it is less severe. No, in fact, we have also done an analysis in which we consider the data of the DANSE, NEOS, and PROSPECT experiments, and also Bouguer 3. And we show that taking into account this proper statistical treatment, then the bounds that they obtain are relaxed. So typically the allowed region increase, and also the bound for the exclusion curve is less severe. So this can be done, but is not so serious a problem as for the neutrino 4, because at least for in the last data, this experiment do not give a strong indication in favor of neutrino oscillation, especially at large mixing. So to say more, so this chi-square analysis are approximate. So that is all that we can do.
Thank you.
Okay, if there are no more urgent questions, I think it's good time to finish. The school will resume in 1 hour and 5 minutes with the lecture on neutrino masses and lepton flavor violation by Sasha Davidson.